to the first in a series of programs made by gay men and lesbians about issues of vital importance to homosexuals. The present government was returned to power in 1987 using this campaign poster, a classic example of fear-mongering at its worst, or, if you prefer, its best. It was an omen of what the party would do in power. I was completely devastated. Never before have I lived in a country which has voluntarily taken backward steps in the areas of personal liberty. Section 28 of the Local Government Act forbade local government and education funding of the promotion of homosexuality. What is that? How can you promote homosexuality? We thought we'd ask the advertising agency who came up with that Conservative Party poster, Saatchi & Saatchi.
Are you prejudiced for or against homosexuals? My view as a psychoanalyst is that one should be tolerant and accepting of homosexuals as full members of society. But I regard homosexuality not as something inborn, but arising during the complex development of personality. This so-called medical view of homosexuality is denied by gay activists. The gay liberation movement wants us to believe that homosexuality is quite normal. But let us condemn any attempt to impose false notions of homosexuality, in particular on our developing youth.
Homosexuality was in the headlines throughout 1987 as some Labour councils took steps to encourage the use of positive images of lesbians and gay men. In December of that year, Clause 28 was added to the Local Government Act. It prohibited the promotion of homosexuality by local governments and education authorities.
I do not want homosexuality promoted.
Object to is promoting homosexuality as a positive alternative way of life.
This bill has created the most incredible backlash and the most incredible fear.
On that, Jenny, let's get
I've been accused on a number of occasions of stirring up bigotry. I haven't. Section 28 of the Local Government Act has got nothing to do with homosexuals. It has got everything to do with using public money to promote homosexuality. That is very different. If there is prejudice, if there is bigotry, if there is discrimination, it exists anyway. And Section 28 was a reflection of that rather than the cause of it.
If I stand up and say, I'm a homosexual, I'm a lesbian, and I'm happy, healthy and adjusted, legal advice has said to me that is promotion. This is what we're worried about.
Those people within the homosexual lobby who have decided for themselves that they want society to change have set about achieving that change in a way that is counterproductive. They have been shrill, they have been boastful, they have been aggressive, they have been self-advertising.
I was promoting the rights of lesbian and gays, and if that is promoting homosexuality, then that's fine, because I was promoting the needs of people. But I find promoting a very strange word. You know, I wasn't trying to sell anyone anything, a product we wanted promoted or anything like that. I was actually talking about people's rights and the needs of people to be aware.
Well, the dictionary is absolutely clear on the matter. There's no difficulty at all. Commercial companies spend a lot of money and a lot of time trying to promote their product, trying to increase knowledge of it, trying to increase the sales of it, trying to increase the use of it. I mean, that's the standard definition of promote, no difficulty at all.
With that definition in mind, Out on Tuesday approached the world's leading advertising agency to see if they could indeed sell the product.
An interesting brief, if ever there was one. I won't tell you what it is, I'll just tell you what the proposition is. Being homosexual is the best way to live. How's that grab you?
Did I hear it right?
When I first got the brief, it was this total sort of disbelief of what to do. I just thought, it can't be done.
Are we actually trying to change straight people to being gay, or are we just trying to defend them?
What's the target?
Yeah, I mean, exactly what we're trying to do. So we're trying to make them become homosexual, not just be more sort of feeling towards gay people.
It's not about saying don't be prejudiced then.
No, I think it's attempting to go further than that. But I mean, whether
actually saying, yeah, you're better off.
Give it a whirl.
But is sexual orientation open to influence? No one can agree.
All the evidence seems to suggest that sexuality is a very intense and early drama, that the symbolic language of sex, which has a lot to do with the way you will, as a sexual being, derive your satisfactions, that symbolic language is forged quite early and has more to do with your relationship to your parents than anything else, or to your immediate circle than to anything else. I mean, there may be genetic predispositions, I don't know, but it seems to me there's very little late on that that makes any difference.
I think that sexual orientation is established in infancy, although people might not be aware of their true desire, and that could come to light only later, which would then produce a change of sexual orientation. Although, as far as the unconscious is concerned, it would have been in place, so to say, very early on.
I think that most people do have within them both an interest in sexual relationships with people of their own sex, and a potential for it, although I think it's stronger in some people than it is in others. And I think circumstance makes a lot of difference to whether you actually realise that, both whether you feel that the people around you are going to be encouraging, or usually the opposite, whether you think that you're going to really suffer.
We lost ground by talking about sexual choice as if it was something you woke up one day and thought. I do think your sexual orientation is pretty much a given.
The opposite position, sort of clause 28 position, is that our sexuality is somehow totally open, and anything that anybody says to us, any persuasive message or manipulative advertising or imagery, will instantly make us change our sexual behaviour from one direction to another. And I don't think either of these absolute positions is true.
I think it's quite possible that I would have continued being heterosexual if I hadn't gone to work in a women's organisation. I think that there was a lot of encouragement, and certainly looking back on it, there are other women who came to work at the project afterwards who I also think possibly would have stayed heterosexual if they hadn't gone to work in a women's organisation.
I think we needed to initially start to probably knock heterosexuality, find what the bad things are about heterosexuality in order to come at it from a slightly different angle.
I mean, say you take a Rolls Royce. Now, it's because the perception is that that is the greatest car in the world, of one kind, you can then sell it on envy. I mean, you can say, wouldn't you like to have one of these? Because you've already done the first half of the argument. That's been done for you, that it's a great car. You haven't done the first half of the argument with homosexuality. You haven't convinced people that it's a wonderful thing, so you can't then say to people, wouldn't you like to be like us?
Best way of approaching it was to try and nudge people away from their prejudices about homosexuality, and to show them that there are, in fact, lots of benefits to it.
The Satches team decided to produce a series of ads and a TV commercial.
I think the tone of voice is quite important. I don't think we should be defensive at all. I think we've got to go, be confident in the ads we do. And I think possibly, you know, the way in is to be quite contentious, but maybe fun at the same time. I think this brief would have been easier to work on 5 years ago. There was a reasonably liberal attitude towards homosexuality, and that's all been totally destroyed now, I think.
But is the issue homosexuality or its public expression?
There is a difference, of course, between homosexuality and being a homosexual and being gay. Homosexuality has always been, has always existed and will continue to exist. Being gay is something new, and we don't know really if it's going to survive or not. And being gay, what is very important about being gay is that it's public. It's making one's sexual orientation public.
I mean, I think the sort of social values that are associated with Thatcherism very much stem from a sort of lower middle class attitude towards sexuality, where it's very much a matter of the private domain. Sexual ideas and attitudes and behaviours should be kept behind locked doors, etc. And it's has a lot of investment in maintaining the respectable moral front.
It doesn't become any of us to parade our private lives in public, any aspect of it. If we simply carried on doing our own thing in our own way, minding our own business, living quietly with each other, life would be a great deal better all around.
Everybody in the House of Commons knows that there are many Labour and Conservative peers who are homosexuals or who have had homosexual experiences before. They're not excluded from the private club of Parliament. People don't refuse to talk to them. But nobody would ever actually bring that knowledge into the public domain and begin to think about the sexuality of other people in the light of what they themselves know and have done. There's this split between the private and the public.
This is where we got to yesterday.
The main point in doing any kind of provocative advertising is to make people think, or possibly talk amongst themselves about a particular topic. When we started to look at ways we could knock heterosexuality, I mean, we did find that there were quite a few good things to have a go at.
You
could actually produce an ad which very, very convincingly points up what negatives there are to be associated with heterosexuality. The ad that we'd probably want to run first would be an ad which quite bluntly says heterosexuality, there ought to be a law against it.
Well, being a woman, I found, I mean, more on the side, sexual side, I knew more women would like want and how they could be unfulfilled by men, and sort of the advantages that other women would have of knowing what would make a woman tick.
It certainly seemed that the advantages for women were, you know, we could list them straight away, you know, no contraception, no pregnancy, all sorts of things like that. The thing about men is, I think there is a problem with AIDS. You've got to, if you like, take into account public opinion, and if public opinion is that it is a gay plague or that it is a gay male plague, you've got to take that into account, and you can't presume they don't think that way.
We'd be foolish to pretend that that problem didn't exist. And I think the honesty of doing that will help the cause of the ads.
There may be a positive in the fact that in LA there's AIDS in the homosexual population has begun to fall, or it certainly hasn't started to increase any. It's not increasing anymore. Whereas in the heterosexual population, I mean, it's still increasing rapidly. And we can turn that into a positive.
We did have several other ideas along the way, including another campaign line, which was why be unhappy when you could be gay. This we gave the overnight test to, which, having initially written it, everyone thought, oh, that sounds good, that sounds about right. But later on, we felt it was either too aggressive or too twee, or could be misread.
Most heterosexuals, when they think of gay women and gay men, have their, you know, straight stereotype people, or with either the men in their sort of leather clad, the butch men, the sort of feminine sort of men. And with the lesbians, I think they think of them either as very butch or ugly or green and common, sort of not your average type of person. So I would not put those kind of people in the adverts. I think you do the kind of people that heterosexuals don't identify with gay people, i.e. people just like themselves.
I think people have a lot of preconceptions about lesbians and gay men, and I don't think I necessarily look like people's stereotype of a lesbian, so the very act of my coming out to someone can challenge their stereotypes of what a lesbian is. I also use my sexuality sometimes in my training. People sometimes get very moralistic about gay men being a high-risk group, and I sometimes say that, well, if you're a heterosexual woman, then you're also in a higher risk group than I am. I'm a lesbian, so if you're talking about risk groups, why don't you become a lesbian? Because it's the lowest risk group there is.
If you're talking about promoting heterosexuality or knocking heterosexuality, it is about sex, ultimately. It is about, your sexual preferences. I think that's what makes it so difficult. It's one of the few things, if you like, that it's not about reasoned argument, it's about instinct. I mean, we show them to people here and make it, on one level they'll say, that's a good ad, and on another level they'll say, but hang on, you can't do that. And what they really mean is, I don't like being persuaded about something which is so important and so personal.
There is a taboo in our society on homosexuality. You see, I think the issue is around the belief that actually you can't make people who are heterosexual into homosexual. That's what the fear is about. And it is possible to promote homosexuality. This is not, but what is not possible is to make somebody a homosexual who doesn't have a desire for it. That is what is not possible. It is possible to make it easier for people to lead a homosexual life. That is possible. More acceptable, even possibly desirable.
I'm not saying everyone, it's great, everyone should be homosexual. That's nonsense. What I'm saying is, be true to yourself, be what you are and what you want to be. And the nonsense that I'm trying to persuade anyone to do something against their will is not, but I was, they tried to force me to do something against my will. Every message I got as a young guy was telling me I had to go out with women, I had to have these certain sexual needs, which I did not have.
I would like to encourage any other woman who felt that she wanted to try lesbian relationships. I would do everything I could to present it as a positive option, because for me it is a positive option.
This Valentine's Day, I finally found a lover who really understands me and even thinks the same way as me. My lover treats me as an equal and understands my needs perfectly. My lover's no more sexually demanding than I am, but we can go on all night if the mood takes us. I don't feel used anymore. I don't have to fake anything. I'm finally off the pill. In fact, I don't need any form of contraception at all. And nor does she.
I wanted to do an ad to try and say to people, which maybe is another campaign, but try and say to people, well, try it, you know, I mean, it might not be so bad. And, but I mean, which is the only thing that I began to think of while I was doing the ads, that perhaps we should try the product.
I changed my sexual habits in 1983. I was walking down New York City on 8th Avenue with a college friend when some colleagues of his approached him and told him that his ex-lover had died of AIDS. He retired to a side street to weep. I got the message. The news of AIDS, like the disease itself, took longer to come to Britain. I'm wondering, how have gay men here responded?
I think people must be made to learn about this thing, whether it's a nice subject or not.
But you can't force people.
But it isn't a question of forcing people. If only they'd heard what the doctor's just been telling us, they'd want to learn. What do you think, Bob?
About what?
About Don't you think we ought to see that everyone knows the facts?
Well, it's rather a grim subject, isn't it?
The Russians have done a bit of that. Educating the people, I mean.
I've seen some American posters, too. We're doing it here as well. Slowly, of course, but it's our way.
Well, what is it you want people to know?
It is something about the inevitable violence of desire that we have to adjust safer sex to, that we feel strongly that our bodies experience desire. There's no point pretending that isn't the case, that sex can always be somehow tranquil and totally oceanic and gentle, rather like, you know, icing a cake or something. Sex isn't like that for any women or any men at the point of actual strong feelings.
Sigma stands for Socio-Sexual Investigations of Gay Men and AIDS. It's based on a 8-location sample of gay men up and down England and Wales, based primarily on London and Cardiff. It's looking at sexual behaviour, seroprevalence of HIV and changes in behaviour over a 3-year period.
And how many men are involved in the study?
In all, it's about 1,000. No doubt at all that for virtually all forms of risk and forms of behaviour, that the type of relationship a person's in makes enormous differences. It makes big differences as well in terms of risk, and I think this is the most interesting part, that, for instance, one state of affairs one can have, a very common one, is that if you have a fairly closed relationship, that people will, the couple will engage in unprotected anal or unsafe sex, but then outside that relationship will engage in only safe sex. Now that's one quite common response to safer sex.
Could you tell me something about the relationship you're in at the moment?
We've been seeing each other for just over 4 years.
Do you practice safe sex within that relationship?
No, in the sense that we have an agreement in that neither of us have other sexual partners or have had that agreement for most of this relationship. And within that, I think we recognise that we make a big assumption that neither of us are HIV positive.
You can trust anyone that far?
I think that you have to, or you'd be so kind of worried or anxious about it that it would just make any relationship impossible. You would just decide that you don't have one. The safest sex you can have is like no sex at all, but who wants to live like that?
How old are you, Colin?
I'm 20.
When did you have your first sexual experience with another man?
When I was 16.
Have you ever had penetrative sex?
No, not yet.
So you could say that all the time you've been having sexual experiences with other men, there's been the AIDS crisis in this country.
Yeah.
How do you think AIDS has affected your sexuality?
I just think it made me more nervous about the whole thing. I was more tentative in what I did, and sort of the time I sort of chose to do it. Like, I think maybe if I hadn't been around, I would have lost my virginity when I was younger. I would have had sex a lot more regularly, I think.
Among younger people, there is a significant decrease in the number of people who actually engage in anal intercourse. But that doesn't mean to say that they don't want to do it. And we have evidence not only on what they do, but what they want to do as well. And often these are out of accord with each other.
Do you think you'll be having any form of penetrative sex in the future?
Imagine so, yeah.
And do you think when that happens, it will be using condoms or not using condoms?
I think it would really depend on the situation. If they weren't there, then I wouldn't particularly worry me, I don't think. Not in this particular relationship.
I work on the assumption that all human sexuality, all sexual encounters, in one way or another, are about power and the exchange of power, giving people permission, even and especially at the point of romantic love. When you say you love someone, you open yourself wide open because that person can just walk away.
Being penetrated is being totally open, being totally not in control in a way that we are taught to be in control as men, and giving that up. Actually giving yourself over in a particular physical way to another man. Now, that is why it is good for the head. And that is why the pleasure is like, it's not just about what's happening down there, but it's about all over and particularly up there as well, for me anyway. Being fucking is about another man allowing that to happen and allowing that to happen with you.
We have to respect the rectum as a sexual organ. And anal intercourse deserves the same kind of respect as any other form of sex. However, at this moment in time, unprotected fucking is a royal road towards HIV infection. And it's a balance between that recognition of the risk factors of unprotected fucking and the way in which we express our love and or desire for one another.
So how has your sexual practice vis-a-vis penetration changed since AIDS?
It's changed in that if and when I do it, I'll make sure condoms are used. And even then, I go, well, you might be taking a risk here, and do you think this risk is worth it? So, of course, it has changed it. And taking on board the fact that I might tomorrow say, actually, I can't risk it at any point, but at the same time going, taking on board the fact that it is a very essential part of the way I view my sexuality, and so therefore what it is going to mean emotionally. And certainly not sitting there being squeaky quick clean and going, oh no, I don't do that.
I think on the one hand we have to respect and understand the differences which pre-exist AIDS in the gay community, and at the same time understand how the power dynamics of human sexuality can be shifted away from practices which might be risky into less risky practices. No single poster can do very much, no single leaflet can do very much. This campaign simply says keep it up. Keep it up in the sense of carry on, well done, congratulations, and also have a good time.
Playing Gay, a story of celluloid seduction, sex.
I'm really glad that it was with a woman the first time on screen.
And disguise.
Every time a heterosexual actor puts a dress on, they give him a fucking Academy Award.
Playing Gay, where the bottom line is the dollar.
Are gay themes good box office?
No.
Where technique is everything.
Helen's a good kisser.
She's a good kisser.
Where discrimination is everywhere.
Gay actors have been essentially told to get out.
And so is the gossip.
I can think of four or five men and women who are either gay or lesbian, who are huge stars.
Playing Gay. Some were defiant.
Would you play a gay role again?
Absolutely.
Playing Gay, starring Harvey Fierstein, Patricia Charbonneau, Garden Warnick, Lynette McKee, and introducing Michael Kearns. Playing Gay, coming soon.
I am an entertainer. Oh, what's left of one? I go by the name Virginia Ham. Ain't that a kick in the rubber parts?
Harvey Fierstein's Tort Song trilogy is due to open in Britain this April.
I need a man.
Fierstein plays Arnold, New York's most memorable drag queen.
Tort Song trilogy is based on a Broadway play, and it is a case of a gay man who has written a serious play, starred in that play, produced that play, and has brought that play to the screen starring himself. Now, I think that that's a unique situation which will not be repeated in the near future. It's a very unusual situation to have had happen.
You know, there are easier things in this life than being a drag queen. But I ain't got no choice. See, try as I may, I just can't walk in flats.
Arnold is different from most gay roles because he exists in a gay world. Most Hollywood movies are a gay person in a straight world, or a gay story set in a straight world. This is a gay story set in a gay world where the heterosexuals come in and sort of torture us, which is much more realistically what my life is like. And for years, as you know, most gay roles were either the funny, tragic friend, or, you know, gays were okay as long as they committed suicide in the final scene, or fell in love with the hero and the hero left him crying in the rain, or something like that. Tragedy and homosexuality is very accepted in Hollywood, but happiness and homosexuality is not.
I would not say that Hollywood's the kinds of roles that Hollywood creates for gay characters are worth playing. These are not roles which are a challenge. These are roles which can be played in your sleep because they are stereotypes.
I have a very strange opinion about heterosexuals playing gays. I mean, every time a heterosexual actor puts a dress on, they give him a fucking Academy Award, and I don't understand it. I mean, we spend our lives playing heterosexuals, and nobody ever gives us any credit for the incredible job we've done. I mean, if heterosexuals had any idea how many of us there really were, and who is it, who is it?
Hollywood is probably the scariest place in the world to be gay because Hollywood is selling an image. And the position of actors and actresses who happen to be lesbians or gay men in Hollywood is a terrifying position. You're talking about people who don't make one single move without pretending.
Michael Kern says he's Hollywood's only out gay actor. Before he said that, he appeared in Cheers, The Waltons, Murder, She Wrote, and the movie Body Double.
My coming out was an evolvement that happened over several years. When I really came out, and came out with a vengeance, and came out angrily and disturbed, was when Rock Hudson died in 1985.
I think it's a very important point to say that people have not started to hate homosexuals, especially not in Hollywood, simply because AIDS came along. These were people who hated homosexuals long before there was AIDS, and now they have an excuse.
Oh, gay actors have been fired. Gay actors have been put in pigeonholes where they're played, you know, where they have to play silly, ridiculous roles. And gay actors have been essentially told to get out or told to hide, to lie, to be deceptive. I mean, there are currently, as you can imagine, dozens of homosexual men in the film and television industry who are shooting series and movies as we speak, probably, who are denying who they are.
So you only get work if you're in the closet?
You get work if you're in the closet.
For gay actors, auditions for leading roles in movies like Body Heat can mean the big chill. Top Hollywood star maker Wally Nasita cast both these movies and knows how the system works.
Are you aware of any personal examples of homophobia in Hollywood?
Yes. I mean, in terms of casting movies and for the director to feel that somebody who is reading for a leading man role and they feel that he is gay and they won't get near them, generally.
Because that happens a lot.
It happens a lot.
I mean, I can think of 4 or 5 men and women who are either gay or lesbian who are huge stars, international stars. I mean, stars on the status of, like, say, Elizabeth Taylor, who are gay. Rock Hudson was one of those people before he died. And now there are 4 or 5 others who will never come out, who the public will never know are gay. They'll simply go to their grave with their secret because their bankability is dependent upon their duplicity.
I don't understand, and I'll never understand, how people can live in the closet. There's not enough time in the day to get everything done that has to be done. If you then have to think who knows that I'm doing it and who doesn't, this has nothing to do with your program, it's probably totally unused, usable footage, but I just began a relationship with somebody who, because of his profession, we had to, for the first 3 weeks of our relationship, not let anybody know we were seeing each other. Jeez, it took a lot of energy to do that. And I can't imagine living your whole life hiding.
I don't think it's sufficiently appreciated how much these people want to work. And so it's very easy, for instance, for a gay activist to say, well, why don't you come out of the closet? Ignoring the fact that you are asking people to throw away their reason for existing, their career.
And if Hollywood is hostile to gay actors, it's even tougher on gay movies.
The heads of the studios are not major gamblers. They're all pretty safe playing people. They want to keep opening these doors to these studios. It costs them a lot of money. They want to make movies that'll make a lot of money. And these have proven historically not to be among them. So they make other choices.
It's naive in a way to expect that this industry, which is dedicated to box office, would integrate lesbians and gay men who are not acceptable in society into motion pictures in a sort of naturalistic, incidental way.
There's a novel now called Mysteries of Pittsburgh, written by a man named Michael Chabon, which is acknowledged to be a wonderful, wonderful book. And it has a homosexual theme. No major studio would get near that book. If it had any other theme, because the quality of the writing, the caliber of the writing is so high, people would run to make it.
So how did Harvey Fierstein get to sing his Torch song?
When it came to doing the movie of Torch Song, we went through lots of different stages. There were people that wanted to buy just the third act, which involves the mother and the adopted son, and had no possibility of my character having sex, of course, to Hollywood. That's what they wanted.
Employment husband, employment wife.
I knew one day we'd have to decide.
Actually, if we could figure that out, we could have our own kids and we wouldn't have to adopt one. What should I put down for age?
Right, 54. Let them break it up.
What age child?
Old enough to dust, that's all I care. The only people that were interested in doing it the way I wanted to do it were either Independence or, like I said, New Line, which is basically a small studio. So nobody made any demands on the script. Once I found New Line Cinema, they said, do what you want. So I had no demands. I was allowed artistic control. I had casting control, director control. I had the final cut of the film, which is unheard of to give the writer and star the final cut of a film. But they allowed me control because they trusted me.
In independent film, there's, I think, much more of a license to explore lesbian and gay male sexuality. And in fact, if you look at My Beautiful Laundrette and you look at Desert Hearts, there's a world of difference between the kinds of sexuality that's portrayed in these films and the kind of limiting that goes on in commercial film.
Follow me.
Hollywood says gay sex is dirty, so My Beautiful Laundrette took it to the cleaners. But straight actors Gordon Warnick and Daniel Day-Lewis had to make it wash. Just how biodegradable did they get?
We just went into this small room and shot it with about 5 or 6 people watching it. It wasn't pre-planned. Stephen Frears asked Daniel and myself to kiss, make love, and then we'll shoot it. So we did it. We showed him the way that we thought it might go. We didn't sit around talking about it for ages and did it.
Thank you.
that was Daniel's idea. There was a bottle of champagne there, and he just decided to go for it. So he picked it up and swallowed some and poured some into my mouth. I think it worked. I mean, a lot of people come up to me and said it was a really good scene.
What the hell are you doing? Sunbathing? Asleep, Uncle. We were shagged out. Where's Papa?
As an actor, how do you play a gay role?
You treat it as the same way as you play any other character, whether it be a bricklayer or a barber or a merchant banker. You look at certain aspects of the character which are similar to yourself, and you put forth that those ideas in the back of your mind when you're acting.
I think any good actor, gay or straight, can play these roles and play them well. And I do not think, in fact, that a gay actor has an edge over a straight actor in that person's ability to portray a homosexual.
There's a certain thing that comes with being gay that allows you to have the layers underneath the certain gay sensibility. I mean, straight people can learn to camp, but that's not what being gay is. We know things that heterosexuals will never know.
When you say, can you think of an actor or an actress who has authentically played a homosexual, it's very difficult to know what that means, because there are as many different kinds of lesbians and gay men as there are different kinds of heterosexuals. So what would be authentic?
Reno, Nevada, where cowboys sing along to Stand By Your Man and the women are faster than the cars. Street actress Patricia Charbonneau played gay in her first movie alongside Helen Shaver and stole some desert hearts.
Well, I play a character named Kay Rivers, and I think it's probably one of the best characters to come along for a woman in a long time. So I was real excited to get the opportunity to play her. She's an ambitious lover of life.
Three guesses who that was.
Do you mind if I smoke?
Was it fun when you were playing the part? Because you're sort of like in the... You're the daredevil, you're the pursuer, you're the seducer. Was it fun playing the traditional male role?
Yes, it was, but I didn't think of it as being the traditional male role at all. I just had a blast with it. I mean, how could you not? She's just this free, loving, wonderful, spirited person. And it was just... It was such a great release to be able to just do that and get paid for it.
But, you know, part of casting in this particular film was a question of working out the chemistry. I mean, the characters had to have chemistry. And after I had chosen Patricia, I came back to Los Angeles, and I was casting for the part of the English professor, which eventually went to Helen Shaver. And when I had narrowed it down to three actresses, I brought Patricia in from New York, because I needed to have Patricia in the room with each of these three actresses reading with them. And when she and Helen read together, it was, it was apparent to me, to the casting director, to the two of them, that was the right combination.
So take your hands out of your pockets and come here. I'm not taking off my robe. Well, everybody draws the line somewhere.
That was the first love scene, obviously, that I did on film. And I've said this before, both to Donna and to some other friends of mine, I'm really glad that it was with a woman the first time on screen.
I choreographed the sex scene entirely. I really should call it a love scene, because it's more of a love scene than a sex scene. Although there is sex in the love scene. And step by step, so that when we shot it, we all knew what was going to happen. It wasn't going to be a question of, well, let's just shoot it every which way and fix it in the cutting room. It was choreographed completely. And it took an entire day, a 12-hour day, to shoot that scene. But what was kind of funny is that there is a scene in the film where they're kissing in the rain. And that's where Patricia Charbonneau's character first kisses Helen's. And this we shot the next day. But it happens days before in the continuity of the movie. And Patricia sticks her head in the window of the automobile, it's raining, and gives Helen this great big kiss, and Helen gives her this great big kiss back. And I said, wait a minute, wait a minute. And they had been so used to kissing each other the day before that they had gotten all, you know, like mixed up in the continuity, and they were kissing each other like, you know, they'd been together for 5 months or something. So I guess that's why it's useful to have a director around now and then.
Is Helen Shaver a good kisser?
Helen's a good kisser.
She's a good kisser.
She's a good kisser.
Where'd you learn to kiss like that?
I don't know where that came from.
Deitch's latest project again casts two heterosexual actresses playing gay. The Women of Brewster Place, an adaptation of Gloria Naylor's novel, has just been shown on American television.
Well, Brewster Place is an American-made four-hour miniseries for ABC television, starring Oprah Winfrey, Cicely Tyson, Moses Gunn, Lynette McKee, and a whole cast of black actors. Everybody in the cast is black.
It is basically the stories of seven or eight black women, and it traces pretty much their lives, particularly Oprah Winfrey's, from the time she is a young girl in the 30s or 40s up through the 50s, 60s, 70s. And it, for myself and for Paula, it is the story of a very deep personal relationship that happens to be gay. These girls happen to be gay. And it is the tragic things that occur with them trying to fit in into the community and trying to act normal or what they perceive as normal, and the fact that they're outcast.
Saddle called, and he and Byron are going to give this birthday party down at the club, and we're going to go. So come on.
Mm-mm. I'm not going over there tonight. I hate that club.
You never hated it before.
I always hated it. The only reason I ever went was because you wanted me to go.
They make me sick with their prancing around. They're nothing but a couple of fags.
So what? We're nothing but a couple of dykes.
I mean, did you sit down with Paula Kelly and say, well, look, these are my thoughts about these two women and how the relationship works?
We did, and with Donna. We did. We had several rehearsals, and Paula and I talked a lot on the phone about it and had a lot of meetings amongst ourselves about it.
Lorraine, you are a lesbian. A dyke, a lesbo, a butch, all those names that boy was calling you, I saw him. And you get around to all the basements in the world, and it's not gonna change anything. Why can't you just accept it?
I have accepted it. I've accepted it all my life. I lost my family because of that. But it doesn't make me any different than anybody else in this world.
It makes you damn different.
No, it doesn't.
Black actors in this country are so totally discriminated against in the first place. It would be ludicrous for me to pass up this wonderful role because of some, you know, fear I have of the way I'm going to be perceived as gay or otherwise. Black people are already so shut out that this is not going to make a difference to my career. I was so honored to get this role. This is not going to matter.
Do you feel that it has harmed your career, playing the part?
I don't know. To tell you the truth, it's been hard for me to get work, but I'm so proud of what I did in that film that my attitude is really, fuck 'em.
Having played a gay role, I hope it hasn't affected my career. It shouldn't, in my eyes. It's stupid if somebody won't see me for a part because I've played a gay role.
People have said to me, aren't you scared that you're going to be pigeonholed into playing only gays? And I said, well, that would be just fine. I mean, that's like saying to Clark Gable, aren't you scared to be pigeonholed into only playing heterosexual characters?
Would you play a gay role again?
Absolutely. Without question.
I don't think I would play another lesbian role, at least not in the near future.
Why?
Because I think I need to do some other work too. I don't want to stay in with the same character either.
I'd play a gay role again if it was a good script and I could believe the character in it.
Are there straight roles that I'd like to do? I don't think yet. I don't think I've seen one I wanted to do yet. I mean, I always had a fantasy of playing Eleanor of Aquitaine, but I don't think it would work. I can do it for, should I do it for the camera and then you can judge. Of course he has a knife. He always has a knife. It's 1183 and we're barbarians. Anyway, I don't know. Not a straight man's role anyway. Not yet. I mean, maybe somebody will write a straight role that I'd bother doing. But to tell you the truth, if AIDS has taught me anything, it's that life is extremely short and you don't know what's going to happen, so don't do bullshit. Don't waste your life doing bullshit. There's too many good things to do. And you know what? If you can't do something you really care about, then stay home and have a good time at home.